Hello everyone, welcome to my lecture series of electromagnetic fields. We will discuss different theories, phenomena and numerical solution of different cases in this series. I hope this series will give a fruitful outcome to physics scholars or engineering students. So previously we have seen the electrostatic flux and flux density. We have also derived the relationship between electric field intensity and electric flux. Today in this video we are going to learn the most important law, that is called Gauss's law. So to understand it, let us consider a sphere with radius r and a charge of say plus q coulomb. So here, due to this charge which is at the center of this sphere, which is nothing but origin in our convention, so it will emit total flux equals to q. Fine, so that we have seen in our previous video, that if the total charge is q, then total flux will be equal to the value of charge. Fine, so we can say that here total flux is q, and if this sphere is having a radius r, then its surface area will be 4 pi r square, will be the surface area, and the density or say flux density will be equal to psi by a. Here we can write d is equals to psi by a because we have assumed that the distribution of flux is uniform throughout the surface. Fine, so we can write q divided by 4 pi r square, and the unit of flux will be coulomb per meter square. And if you want to represent this flux density in terms of vector, then we can say vector d is equals to q upon 4 pi r square r caret. So if we consider a spherical coordinate system, then the direction of flux density will be the direction of r coordinate of the coordinate system, and unit will be coulomb per meter square. Fine, now secondly, if we assume a line charge, say we have a finite line with some length L and some charge density lambda coulomb per meter. Fine, so in this case also, if we want to find out the flux, then what can we do? That we will simply multiply. Now assume that this charge distribution is uniform, so I am taking a uniform positive charge distribution on this line, and the length of this line is say small l. Okay, so total charge here will be lambda into length of line. Again, the Gaussian surface is same, which is sphere, and its area is 4 pi r square. So in this case, for second case, for this line charge distribution, the flux density will be lambda into L divided by 4 pi r square, again r caret, or say radius coordinate will be the direction of flux density. Fine, now it is true for any kind of charge distribution. Fine, and these are the observations of Michael Faraday, and these observations lead to the very famous law which is called Gauss law. So whatever we have discussed up till now is just a prerequisite to understand the logic behind the Gauss law. Fine, now in third case, consider that we have a point charge inside the sphere, so say this one, and we have another point charge outside the sphere. So for this case, what will be the resultant? You see, so here q1 will have some electric flux, and q2 will also have some electric flux, but the flux due to q2 will enter in some amount in our Gaussian surface and will leave the surface by the same amount. So as you can see, the flux of Q2, see, because here both charges are positive, so their flux distribution will be quite like this. This distribution we have also seen in our previous lectures. Fine. So there will be a midline on which the potential will be zero. Okay. So as you can see, due to this charge Q2, whatever amount of flux is entering the Gaussian surface, the same amount of flux is leaving the Gaussian surface. Fine. That means any charge outside of Gaussian surface has no effect on the total flux passed through any surface. And with the base of this statement, the Gauss law states that electric flux passing through any closed surface is equal to the total charge enclosed by that surface, or psi is equal to Q enclosed. That means for any surface, the total flux passed is only dependent on how much charge that surface have enclosed. Fine. Any outside charge of that surface will have no effect on the total flux passing through that particular surface. So this is a very important statement, and with the help of this statement we are going to learn many things in future. So now, mathematical representation of Gauss's law. So now consider an object of irregular shape. So whatever we have discussed up till now was on the sphere. Fine. But the same thing is equally applicable for any regular or irregular shaped surface. So here I have taken a surface which has very random shape. Fine. And there is some charge Q. Now this Q may be point charge or line charge or surface charge, anything. Fine. So distribution may be anything is there, which is enclosed by the irregular closed surface. So as we have shown, a closed surface and there is some charge Q. Fine. We have also shown the direction of electric field. So now the direction of field will be same as direction of flux density. Okay. And we have assumed at point a small differential surface at point P. So here ds is this small differential surface that we have assumed on point P. An, or it is a normal direction which shows the direction of this surface, and assume that these two direction makes an angle theta with each other. Okay. So considering a differential surface at point P, we can write ds bar is equals to ds, that is magnitude of this small surface, or say area of this small surface, into an bar, or we can also say there's an bar. Okay. Now flux density at point P, d bar is equals to epsilon e bar. We have derived that equation in last lecture, and its direction is such that it makes an angle theta with normal direction at P. So we have already shown that these two vectors are making angle theta with each other. The flux passing through the surface ds is the product of normal component of flux density and differential area. So d psi is equals to the value of d psi is equals to normal component of flux density multiplied by the area, where dn bar is equals to d cos theta. Now what will be the normal component? Normal component means the component of e bar in the direction of surface. So here we can say this is the normal component of flux density, and if this here we can represent d or e, both have the same meaning. Fine. So this will be the normal component, and this normal component is nothing but the cosine component of d bar. So we have represented dn is equals to modulus of d bar into cos theta, and d psi can now be represented as modulus of d bar cos theta ds. Now this is nothing but a definition of dot product. So we can write d phi is equals to d bar dot ds. Now, this is the flux passing through the differential surface, or say differential area ds, and hence we can determine the flux passing through the entire surface by taking closed surface integration. So now we will do the closed surface integration. As you can see, closed surface integration of this equation, say this is equation 1. So d bar dot ds bar will be calculated on all over the surface. Doing so, the closed surface or with the surface integration is carried out is called the Gaussian surface. See, this is a very important definition to be remembered as far as the exam is concerned and basic understanding regarding Gauss law is concerned. Irrespective of the shape of surface and charge distribution, total flux passing through the surface is nothing but the total charge enclosed by that surface. And if there are more than one charge distribution in Gaussian surface, the net charge is algebraic addition of all individual charges. Now this third point means, say if we have three charges, or say more than three charges, I have one charge Q1 over here, second charge Q2 over here, third charge that is out of my surface Q3 over here, fourth charge is over here, and fifth charge is over here. Now say Q1, Q3 and Q5 are positive, so Q1 is positive, Q3 is positive and Q5 is positive, Q2 and Q4 is negative charges, so we have assigned a direction. So for such cases, if we are required to find the flux passing through this sphere, then we can write phi total is equals to summation of Q enclosed. This is also form of Gauss's law. So here total enclosed charges are only 3, Q1, Q2 and Q4, and here we have taken summation, so algebraic sum of Q1, Q2 and Q4 will be the total flux. So we can finally write plus Q1 minus Q2 minus Q4. So this will be the value of total flux passing through the surface. So this is also a valid representation of Gauss's law. Moving further, special Gaussian surfaces. So if no charges are enclosed by the surface but there are charges around the surface, then net flux over the surface is zero, because the flux from outside charges will pass through the surface, such like the flux entering is the same as flux leaving the surface. So I have already explained this thing in the very beginning of this lecture. So there are some characteristics which should be observed by any surface to be a Gaussian surface. Fine. In other words, there are some conditions which should be satisfied for any surface to be defined as Gaussian surface. Okay. So let us see what are these conditions. The very first condition is the surface must be sufficiently large to enclose the entire charge. Secondly, it must be a closed surface. Any open surface cannot become the Gaussian surface. The surface must be closed, because in the definition itself we need to take the closed surface integration of d bar dot ds bar. That is why. And thirdly, the flux density should be constant and the direction is either normal or tangential at every point of this surface. So this third definition is very crucial and it must be satisfied. Fine, we will see in upcoming lectures, wherever we will solve any particular case, at that time we will see that either our Gaussian surface is satisfying all these three conditions or not. Fine, but for this moment only, we need to remember that any surface cannot be Gaussian surface. Fine, there are certain conditions which must be satisfied to be the Gaussian surface. Now, limitations of Gauss's law. Actually, it is very general form or general law which is equally applicable, but although there are some limitations which cannot be overcome. So the first is, it is applicable to symmetrical problems but cannot be applicable to non-symmetrical problems. The problem is said to be symmetrical if the flux density is normal to the Gaussian surface everywhere. Secondly, it cannot be applied on non-Gaussian surfaces. And thirdly, it can only be applied if the surface encloses the volume completely. Fine. So whatever three was the condition for becoming any surface to be a Gaussian surface are equally reflected as the limitations of Gauss's law. Applications. So what are the fundamental need of Gauss's law? So this is in fact an alternative statement of Coulomb's law, and hence it can be used to determine the electric field intensity and flux density for symmetrical charge distributions such as point charge, line charge, sheet charge, spherical charges, etc. This law is also used to find the charge enclosed or the flux passing through the closed surface. Fine, because it is very easy from that definition itself. Now, whether the charge distribution is symmetrical or not, Gauss's law holds good for any closed surface, but it can be applied easily on symmetrical charge distribution. Fine. So it is not that if the distribution is non-symmetrical, then Gauss's law does not apply. It is equally applicable, but there will be some difficulty of selecting Gaussian surfaces in case of non-symmetrical charge distribution. Fine. So on that point, our calculation may get tedious or say quite impossible to come at any fruitful conclusions. Okay. And lastly, proof of Gauss's law. So I have taken a very simple case in which I have taken a sphere of radius r, which is placed on the origin, which and I have placed a charge plus q on the center of the sphere. Fine. I have also shown some differential surface in the direction of r. Okay. So one can easily prove Gauss's law just by applying it on a point charge. Fine. So we are going to apply Gauss's law on this point charge and we'll see if it is true or not. Now, to determine the field intensity and flux density, let's consider a charge plus q placed at the origin. Consider a spherical surface as Gaussian surface, as it satisfies all the conditions of Gaussian surface for this charge distribution. So we had three conditions. The first was the surface must enclose the charge. So as you can see, our surface is enclosing the charge plus q. Thirdly, it must be closed surface. So we have taken a sphere which is a closed surface. And thirdly, the direction of field intensity must be normal or tangent to every point. So as you can see over here, the direction of field intensity is normal at every point. So all three conditions of being a Gaussian surface is being satisfied with this sphere of radius r. That is why we can take it as a Gaussian surface and calculate further. The direction of d bar is along the direction of r coordinate of adopted spherical coordinate system. So as you can see, the direction of d bar, or say flux density, is also in the direction of radius. So differential surface in the direction of radius in spherical system is ds bar equals to r square sin theta d theta d phi ar bar. And now the flux density at the point can be given as d bar equals to q upon 4 pi r square ar bar. Fine. The flux phi can be given as the dot product of flux density and differential surface area. That is, d phi is equals to d bar dot ds bar, which is nothing but modulus of d bar modulus of ds bar cos theta bar. Here theta is an angle between d bar and ds bar, but as you can see, flux density and the area both are having the same direction, which is ar bar. So angle between d bar and ds bar equals to 0. So we can say theta dash equals to 0, which implies that cos theta dash equals to 1. Fine. So this term last term of this equation will turn out to be unity. It is not necessary that in every case it will be turned out to unity, fine. But in this particular case, we are having the angle 0, that is why. Now, the angle between flux density and surface is 0, and hence d psi is equals to modulus of d bar modulus of ds. Now, what we will do? Total flux can be determined by taking the closed surface integration of above equation. So, if we take the closed surface integration and putting all the values, then we will have closed surface integration q upon 4 pi r square, which is nothing but the magnitude of d bar dot ds bar having the magnitude r square sin theta d theta d phi. Fine, both were having the direction ar bar, so ar bar dot ar bar will be 1. Fine, but we have not shown over here. So psi will be double integration, because we are having a cross surface integration, that is why. So here r square will get cancel out, and the only thing remain will be q upon 4 pi into sin theta d theta d phi. The limit for theta is 0 to pi in spherical coordinate system, and limit of phi is 0 to 2 pi to becoming a closed Gaussian surface. Now, performing this integration, we will have q upon 4 pi. The integration of sin theta will be minus cos theta, lower limit will be 0, upper limit will be phi, and integration of 1 with respect to phi will be phi itself with lower limit 0 and upper limit 2 pi. Simplifying this thing, now this proves the Gauss's law that q coulombs of flux crosses the surface if q coulombs of charge is enclosed by that surface. So if we simplify this, then we will have q upon 4 pi into bracket minus into minus 1 minus minus 1. So it will turn out to be plus 2. This square bracket will turn out to be plus 2. And here 2 pi minus 0 will be 2 pi. So 2 into 2 pi will be 4 pi. 4 pi, 4 pi will be cancelled out. So finally psi is equals to q. And this final relation proves that Gauss's law is correct. So this proves that Gauss's law and q coulomb of flux crosses the surface if q coulomb of charge is enclosed by that surface. Now, steps to use Gauss's law. From the very next video, we will try to find out the field intensity and flux density of different charge distribution with the help of Gaussian law. So it will be quite revision practice, because we have already performed the same task with the help of Coulomb's law. From next video, we will use Gauss's law for the same. Fine. So let us discuss some steps which need to be kept in mind whenever we are using Gauss's law to determine E bar or D bar for any symmetrical charge distribution. So the very first step is to identify flux density and its direction. Secondly, identify the differential surface on Gaussian surface and its direction. So after identifying the density and direction, we'll identify the Gaussian surface and direction of differential surface of on that Gaussian surface. Then we will take the dot product of field flux density and Gaussian surface, that is d bar dot ds bar. The third part is taking the dot product. Then integrate over the full Gaussian surface, keeping d unknown. Now this integration will nothing but double integration, fine, in whatever coordinate system you are taking. Fine, it is not necessary that every time spherical coordinate system will be helpful. Fine, it will only be dependent on the nature of charge distribution. Fine, we will see how does the selection of coordinate system matters for solving different cases. Then find charge q enclosed by the Gaussian surface and equate the charge with integration obtained in four steps. So this is our fourth step. Fine. In fifth step, we will find the enclosed charge by the Gaussian surface, and in sixth step, we will equate this with this integration that we have already calculated. And finally, we will determine the flux density and field intensity. So first thing that we will have will be the value of density, and after that we will have the value of field intensity. Okay, so these are 7 steps which should be very clear in our mind in order to use the Gauss's law to solve any practical cases. Thank you.